EICO 460 Oscilloscope, 1954. This video is part of a hobby project with the hope that it could provide useful information. If you see or hear something horribly wrong in what I do, it might be helpful if you took the time to let me know. This is a vacuum tube oscilloscope, part of a series of kits made by EICO starting from the late 1940s. This particular model was designed in 1954 and was available as a kit or already wired by the factory. This is the advert appearing in the EICO catalog in 1968 and in 1974, page 15. The particular unit under restoration was clearly built by the factory. While restoring or servicing any oscilloscope, one should bear in mind that very high voltages are involved. This particular model might not reach 1000 volts, but when the chassis is outside of its case, the dangerous connections are exposed in places where one would very likely want to put their hands to move the item. The pictures show only some examples, but many other places in the circuit are very dangerous as well. So please be very careful if you power on an oscilloscope outside of its case. And remember, if you are following along, you are doing so at your own risk. The schematic diagram of this oscilloscope is relatively simple. The power supply. The horizontal sweep, the vertical amplifier, the CRT. The horizontal sweep frequency is organized in different intervals, controlled by the rotary switch S3. The first position would allow using an arbitrary capacitor for a personal preferred interval, possibly very low. The last two positions are meant to be used especially for television servicing, making it easier to switch from two different views of the video signal. The item under restoration appeared to be modified, like it appears in the picture. It is unclear the function of this different configuration, though. This video comes with written documentation, where one could also find the maps of most components labeled according to the schematic diagram. See the links in the description, appearing under the Show More tab. A typical restoration of an old electronic unit implies at least the replacement of the electrolytic capacitors. This is all well except that the old electrolytic capacitors could afford to stand peak voltages higher than the working ones for a short period of time. This is not the case with new capacitors. If it is possible to test the unit before starting the restoration, it is important to verify the B+ voltage across the electrolytic capacitors that are supposed to work already at a significantly high voltage. In this case, the capacitors C27 should be checked. They are rated for 450 volts, but the AC voltage reaching the plates of the 6AX5 rectifier is supposed to be up to 400 volts RMS, which without load could be potentially rectified into a B+ higher than 550 volts. The 6X5 rectifier has an indirectly heated cathode, which means that it would be able to provide the B+ only when the other tubes are ready to draw current from the B+ line. In fact, under this circumstance, the unit shows that there is no overvoltage across the electrolytic capacitors, which allows replacing them without the need of a higher insulation. However, please notice that every unit should be checked this way because there could be differences in the power transformer characteristics and/or in the mains. Another aspect to consider is that, under the circumstances, the 6X5 rectifier could not be replaced with a couple of silicon diodes because that would always provoke an initial voltage surge that the capacitor C27 would not be able to stand unless it is rated for 600 volts. If possible, also the high negative voltage used for the CRT should be checked before replacing the C25 and C26 capacitors. In this case, the rectifier does not have a cathode and it is immediately conductive. The negative high voltage is immediately available. It has been possible to verify that this high negative voltage does not go beyond minus 1000 volts, and therefore that C25 and C26 can be used with an insulation of only 1000 volts, as specified in the original schematic diagram. This unit has 3 electrolytics in a single can, and 2 more single ones, all related to the power supply. B+, B-. While restoring the unit, this particular set of electrolytics has been put together in a single board to be located in the same area but under the chassis. The written documentation that comes along with this video contains better details of the construction of the board. Anyway, it should be noticed that one capacitor is connected to the chassis ground with its positive terminal, and that there is an extra fuse connected in the B+ line between the output of the rectifier tube and the first capacitor, C27E. The restoration requires the replacement of all electrolytic and paper capacitors. Also, the resistors should be considered, and ideally they should all be changed. However, old resistors often have very thick leads, stronger than the soldering tags, which makes the desoldering process difficult and potentially harmful for components like the tube sockets and the rotary switches. For this reason, only the resistors that needed to be changed or that were connected on the same tags of capacitors that had to go have been replaced. Initially, for the capacitors C25 and C26, used for the negative high voltage necessary for the CRT, ceramic capacitors have been tried. But using them, the negative high voltage was not stable and every representation on the CRT screen appeared very confused. It has been necessary to use film capacitors for this purpose. The item appeared already modified. The external capacitor connection was used for something else related to the horizontal sweep, although it is unclear the exact function. It might have been used for synchronizing another device, as an impulse from the horizontal sweep could be obtained from that banana socket. Also, considering that S3, the horizontal sweep interval switch, was not working very well, with the occasion of the restoration, a new switch has been installed, with more positions. Consequently, a different set of values for the capacitors used for this function has been chosen. The new set would allow to start from a lower interval, ending also to a higher one. To avoid confusion, a clear plate has been put in front of the S3 knob so that the original sweep intervals are not visible. After a process that implies the replacement of components, or after a significant period of time, the oscilloscope requires repeating some internal adjustments and calibration. In this video, only a couple of essential aspects are considered. A better description could be found in the documentation that comes along with the video. See the links in the description under the Show More tab, and with more details in the original service manual of the oscilloscope, also available online. Turning on and initial setting. As a starting point, initially the unit is turned on after setting almost all controls to about half of their values. In particular, the vertical attenuator should be set to calibration, and the horizontal selector should be set to plus, so that a sine wave could be visualized on the CRT screen. Also, the two lower connectors for the vertical input should be shorted together. Astigmatism. The panel controls should be adjusted so that a few cycles of the calibration sine wave could be visualized occupying about half of the screen vertically. Then, the focus and intensity controls should be adjusted to improve the sharpness if possible, but without exceeding with the intensity of the trace that is visualized. The astigmatism would be evidenced by the presence of unevenly thick parts of the trace. The control R81 should be used together with the focus control to make the visualization of the trace appear more evenly. Vertical trace position. This adjustment is necessary to have the same vertical alignment. The vertical input is shorted so that no signal and no hum can be perceived by the oscilloscope. Then, the vertical attenuator is put to maximum AC attenuation, and the vertical gain is put initially to the maximum as well. The vertical position is used then to align the horizontal trace to the center of the CRT screen. Then the vertical gain is moved to the minimum value and the control R16 on the side of the chassis is used to align again the horizontal trace to the center of the CRT screen. This process might be repeated if moving again the vertical gain to the opposite side affects the vertical position of the trace. Vertical linearity. This type of adjustment is necessary to make sure that the amplification of the trace appearing on the upper part of the screen is the same as the one of the lower part of it. The adjustment is made on R26 and R27 with the purpose of having the same voltage differential between the control grid and the cathode of V3 and V4. This voltage differential should be of about -2 volts, but if this value is not reachable, and only a lower negative value is obtainable, that should be the same for both vacuum tubes. If the measurement cannot be performed with a high impedance voltmeter, then two identical voltmeters should be used simultaneously, so that the influence that they add to the circuit could be exactly the same while performing the alignment. Please notice that the voltmeter or voltmeters are not connected to the chassis ground, and therefore they should also be isolated from the earth ground. The service manual also recommends verifying the voltage differential between the screen grid and the cathode of these two tubes, which should be the same for both tubes and about 150 volts. But the unit under restoration could reach only about 100 volts. This piece of equipment has been born for being used with a power socket without the ground connection. By design, the chassis and the metal case are isolated from the mains, but there is no guarantee against accidental internal short circuits. Having the chassis and the case isolated from the mains, including from the external ground, offers some degree of freedom in connecting the ground side of the oscilloscope probe. However, in the process of restoration, the power cord is replaced with one containing the ground wire connected to the chassis, but also another fuse is added. In fact, the unit will be used in an environment where the power sockets are not polarized, and it is impossible to know which side is hot and which one is neutral. So, with two fuses, each end of the power line has its own. Here is the restored EICO 460 under test, starting with the lower frequencies, with an amplitude of 100 millivolts peak to peak. This is 100 Hz. kHz. 10 kHz. 100 kHz. 1 MHz. 1 MHz. Using the internal synchronization, it is practically impossible to see stable pictures of frequencies above 1 MHz. Slightly modulated 3 MHz. 1 MHz. It is possible to get a stable picture of a sine wave at 6 MHz, only feeding the same wave at about 10 volts peak to peak into the external sync input. Signals above 5 MHz are significantly attenuated with this oscilloscope. Therefore, the wave that is visualized here has been fed to the vertical input at 500 millivolts peak to peak. If you would like to contribute to this project, donating old electronics, old equipment, or old radios in whatever condition they might be, that could be helpful for my next restoration documentation.